Welcome all to our open house event. So in the next two presentations, Pete and I will handle our chemical characterization setup. So I will keep it simple. So for some of you, it will be repetition, but for others that are quite new in the field, it will be just the basics of a chemical characterization. But first, let's stand still to today. So today it's 28th of February, and it's a very important day in history, especially if you are a biologist like I am. So I'm not sure if there are other biologists in the room, but I suspect there are. So what happened on 28th February 1953? Watson and Crick discovered the structure of the DNA helix. So I think that's a very important discovery because it allows now treatments of different cures. And today, it's again 28th of February. And we will now introduce you to our chemical characterization and show what is in the DNA of Nelson Labs. So, and also try to reveal some secrets of medical devices. So let's start with the beginning, the introduction on chemical characterization. I based myself on the new draft 18, and so just yesterday we received the final version of it, which now went to the secretariat of the ISEC committee, and the FDIS probably will be released May of this year, and a final version February next year. So just for your information, keep an eye on it. So in this new draft, there are different aims for a chemical characterization. And first, I want to point out where Pete and I will talk about. So if you look in the dash 18, you will see chemical characterization. The aim can be to look, what is the configuration of my medical device? Or what is the exact composition of my medical device? So of each of the materials of composition, to know how much of each of those are present. Or what is the influence of the manufacturing process? Like Audrey already explained, which processing aids have been used? These are all information which you could theoretically gather by asking your supplier, looking in literature, comparing with a predicate device, and which can be captured and summarized in the material characterization section of your biological evaluation plan. And then, as Audrey already said, but we are going to repeat some things a few times so that when you go home, the message stays there. So then you look, what information do I have already? And with this information, am I able to assess the risk for the patient? And am I completely 100% sure that there is no risk for the patient? So when putting my device on the market, is it safe? So you have to bear in mind that when you have your device manufactured, there are still some steps that are there. So you put mostly your device in a packaging, which then is sterilized. There can be inks on the packaging, glues. So there are other processes involved, which are harder to predict by literature. So that's exactly why it's also asked to do extractables and leachables testing, because these cannot be predicted by literature alone. So, and therefore also these tests require analytical testing. So let's first go to the definitions of extractables and leachables, because we see there still is some confusion about these concepts. So actually it's quite simple. Extractables are the set of compounds which can be extracted from your medical device under worst case conditions. So actually it should be the whole set of compounds which have the potential to end up in a patient, but it does not mean that they will end up in a patient. While in leachables are actually the compounds that come off your material and will end up in your patient under normal use conditions. So this also makes it more clear. Let's say the bar is your medical device, and where you're interested in is in these compounds that end up in a patient. So which compounds are migrating from your device into the patient? This is described in ISO 10993-18, but the final goal, as Audrey also already explained, is which of these compounds are toxic and could be harmful for a patient. So this is then described in ISO 10993-17. Also, since most medical devices are solid devices, and also since they are used in a patient which has tissue, blood, and so, it's hard to really do a leachable study, because how are you going to mimic the real use conditions? You cannot do an extractable leachable study in a human body. So most studies are extractable studies. The chemical characterization studies we will talk about today are the extractable studies. And like Audrey, I like to put the things in three phases. So there are three steps in such an extractable study. So the first is you need to extract your compounds from your medical device. The second step is to detect them. Yeah, I told you already I'm a biologist, so I always try to put some biology in a presentation. And so the last step is you need to identify the compounds. And then if you have identified, a toxicologist will check whether or not these compounds are toxic. So therefore, it's important, those three steps. So you need to extract, detect, and identify the whole set of potentially hazardous compounds. Because missing a compound will mean that the toxicologist will not assess it, so it could be a fatal error for patient safety in the worst case. So let's go to the first step, the extraction. So in the past, as Audrey also said, the extraction was related to ISO 10993-12, but now, in the new -18, the sample preparation will be described completely in the -18, so you will not need to refer to the 12 anymore. The reason is that chemical characterization is a different type of study compared to all other biocompatibility tests. And also, it needs to be relevant for your medical device. So you have more flexibility to really look, what is my device, how it's used, and what is the best setup for my device. So there are two main questions we ask when a customer comes to us and we need to set up a chemical characterization study. So the first is, we look at the type of the device. The second is, what will be the analytical evaluation threshold to be used? So there it comes, the analytical evaluation threshold, the new concept. So I will briefly explain it here already. So an AT, this is just a definition that is in the 18. I will read it, or you can read it. But it's defined as the threshold below which the analyst need not to identify or quantify leachables or extractables or report them for potential toxicological assessment. So when I said with the mushrooms, you need to extract, detect, and identify the whole set, it means you need to extract, identify, and detect the whole set above this calculated analytical evaluation threshold. And how are you going to calculate this? So Yeah, this also explains a little bit what it means. It can be that low concentration is not harmful for the patient, but a higher concentration is harmful for the patient. So it's important that you detect during your chemical characterization the concentrations that are harmful for the patient. And the thresholds used here is the threshold of toxicological concern. Alternatively, but we see that's not often used in a medical device world, where it's more used in the pharma world, is the safety concern threshold. So this threshold of toxicological concern, it also comes from the pharma world, and it's described in ICH-M7. So you see here where it's about. It's about DNA reactive impurities. Ah, I just realized there the DNA is again. I just now see it. So there, for the threshold, you need to look at the daily dose the patient is getting. So for medical devices, they're the most important ones because of the categorization of medical devices is the 120 micrograms per day. For the devices with a time of contact less than 30 days, or the 1.5 for the long-term contacting devices. But we are actually not using 120 micrograms per day in most cases. As we know from the pharma world, it's advised to use 5 micrograms per day because this is the threshold for irritation and sensitization. So you would say, okay, let's lower my analytical evaluation threshold from 120 to 5, and also irritation and sensitization tests are covered. But no, I strongly say here, you cannot replace sensitization and irritation at the moment with chemical characterization, because irritation, it's a local effect that you have, and it's hard to predict this based on the structure of a chemical compound, because an effect on one place cannot happen on another place. So therefore, you still need to do sensitization and irritation testing also when you have done a chemical characterization using a threshold of 5 micrograms per day. So an example of calculation is, let's look at this device, which comes from our movie. It's an implant. And what's important that you know how much of your device is used in one patient in one day. So here it's only one. And the time of contact, it's more than 30 days. So then you go from your TTC, which is described in ICH-M7, to a device-specific TTC. Yeah, here it's a really easy calculation. 1.5 micrograms per day, one device used per day, so 1.5 microgram per device. Then you have your extraction ratio. So here, 4 devices are extracted in 400 ml. That means your analytical evaluation threshold, it's 1.5 micrograms in 100 ml. So you see here, before, and I'm not sure we can check with TÜV-SÜD, the extraction ratio was based on ISO 10993-12, and it was more like the 3 cm² per ml. But we know from FDA, they are not looking at it so much. They are really looking, do you reach the analytical evaluation threshold with the extraction ratio that you have applied, and they will not strongly look anymore at, it was it really 3 cm² per ml? The extraction ratio of 3 cm² per ml is not so important in a chemical characterization study. But what is important is the uncertainty factor that is used on your calculation of the analytical evaluation threshold. I will not go in too much detail for this. You can ask me or someone of the team how we exactly use it. But in Nelson Labs, we use an uncertainty factor of 2. I've also seen in the new draft, Dash 18, they also are using an uncertainty factor of 2. But there are a lot of discussions going on at the moment in the regulatory field. The FDA, they have a preference to use an uncertainty factor of 4. And also, because there are so many discussions going on, these discussions will move to the ISO 10993-17, so they will continue. But at the moment, we still can continue using an uncertainty factor of 2. So you apply this, and then you get your final analytical evaluation threshold, which you need to use in your analysis. You just divide by the uncertainty factor. So a first thing you need to know before you set up your extraction study is this final AT, as it will determine the number of devices you are going to use and the extraction ratio, which is technically feasible. Another parameter is the extraction solvent you are going to use, and of course the extraction condition. So as I said, the next thing you're looking at is your type of device, so the time of contact and the type of contact. So here, let's go first to a device which has a long-term contact with the human body. So there, in the new 18, it's still recommended to use at least 2 solvents, a polar and a non-polar solvent. And then, dependent on the tissue where the device is in contact with, you need to use a third solvent. For example, for blood contacting devices, it's recommended to also use a semipolar solvent. Extraction technique here is exhaustive extraction. So exhaustive extraction means that you need to prove that you extract all possible chemical compounds that can come off your material while using this extraction technique. Before, it was recommended to use NVR, so non-volatile residue, for determination of exhaustiveness. Now there are discussions going on also using alternative techniques, which gives you also more freedom to demonstrate this exhaustiveness. But it's important to know, for devices with long-term contact, you need to use exhaustive extraction. And then here, for the amount of sample and extraction ratio to be used, you start from the TTC of 1.5 micrograms per day. Another example is a device with prolonged contact. So as Audrey said, there you need to look at your biological evaluation plan and see whether or not chemical characterization is required. But when it's required, extraction solvents here are very similar to the permanent implants. So it are again analytical solvents that are proposed in the ISO 10993-18, the polar and the non-polar, and then when there is blood contact, a semipolar solvent. Extraction technique here, there is a preference for exhaustive extraction, but you can also use exaggerated extraction conditions, which save you time because you do not need to demonstrate exhaustiveness. When you are using exaggerated extraction conditions, you need to justify this in your chemical characterization report. What is exaggerated? It can be that the time of contact is longer, the temperature is longer, or more devices than actually being in contact are being extracted in a ratio that would correspond to one device that is extracted. So more devices. That's all exaggerated. And then for determining the amount of samples to be used and extraction ratio, yeah, you can base yourself on 5 micrograms per day. The last example I want to show is in case you have a device where there is a fluid administered to the patient. So that's a special case, and here it shows you the flexibility that now is in the 18. So for extraction solvent, you can only use one solvent, but this solvent would really need to be mimicking the solvent that is used with your medical device. So for example, biological fluid simulant like blood, you have to look in literature what is a good replacement for blood, or a sodium chloride. You will do your extraction with sodium chloride instead of water or hexane. For the extraction technique, you will not do the shaking and incubation, but you will really look at how the device is used so you can circulate the fluid through your device during your extraction so that it really mimics the actual use of your device. And here again, of course, extraction ratio here is a bit strange. It means, yeah, of course, you will just put the same volume as during real use in your device. But it means what will be the TTC you're going to base yourself up and how many samples then I need to use during my chemical characterization. So when you have defined all this, you can start and you will do your extraction, and in the end you will have an extract. And so you need to detect all the compounds above this final ET in your extract. So in this extract there are all types of compounds. There are small compounds, medium-sized compounds, large compounds, and a lot of devices, yeah, they have metals. So there are also often metals in your extract. So in compound set, it corresponds to the small are the most volatile compounds, medium size have a semi-volatility, and the large compounds, they are non-volatile, and then you have metals. Why these are split up is because there is not one single technique to capture them all. You need to use different technique to analyze the compounds with different volatility. So I will not go into details because there will be lab tours in our lab during lunch break, and there they will explain more on the technical details, I guess, of the techniques. But here you see the small compounds, they are analyzed with Headspace GCMS. So, and here is listed the typical compounds you find with this technique. The medium-sized compounds, they are analyzed with gas chromatography. The larger compounds with liquid chromatography. But the result of all those techniques, it's a chromatogram. What is a chromatogram? Some of you are probably familiar with it, others less familiar with it. So in a chromatogram, you see here the retention time, so that means all your compounds are put on a column and they elute from this column based on their size. And so you see them here represented, the compounds eluting from the column. And here there is the abundance, so how much is present of this compound in your extract. And then the elements, they require a different technique. It's ICP, OES or MS. Again, this probably is also part of your lab tour, or if you would need more technical explanation, you can come to us. There's just no time to explain it all into detail. So then you have them detected, all the compounds in your extract, and then the last step is you need to identify them. So here you start from your chromatogram, and then it becomes clear why there was a need for an analytical evaluation threshold. Because you need to decide which compounds you are going to identify. Am I going to identify the compounds, this compound? Am I going to identify only this compound? There was no clear rule for this, and therefore the regulatory said there needs to be a rule to define where you need to set the limit. So when you have calculated the final EET, you can say, okay, we need to identify all the compounds above a certain concentration level. In this case, it are 8 compounds, and this is a typical example of a GCMS chromatogram, so a chromatogram representing the medium-sized structures or molecules. So identification is done by mass spectrometry, because this is also a technique where not all of you are familiar with. I will again explain the basics. Pete will go into more detail maybe. So this is a mass spectrum. Again, you have two axes, and here on the x-axis you have the mass over charge, and then here again you have the abundance. So what actually happens is you have your compound and it's fragmented in masses of different weights, and they all have a specific abundance. So you can see it here, and often the last mass in your chromatogram represents the molecular weight of your compound. So then you go with this combination of masses and you look for the same combination in a library, and you hope then to go have a unique identification of your compound. So here that's what you do. You have your mass spectrum, you compare it with a mass spectrum in the database, and you end up with an identification, the same here. You compare it and you come to an identification. However, if you have ever done a comparison with a mass spectral library, you will see that you will have several hits and not just one hit. So you will also receive a hit with another spectrum, but here you can clearly see there are some small differences, like the abundance of this mass 73. So you will also end up with a name of a compound, but what it means is that your compound is similar to the real compound, but it's not exactly the same. So it's very important that you look at your match factor. It's called the match factor. So how much is your original spectrum similar to the spectrum in the library? Here you have a spectrum that only is matches with 24%. So what does this mean? It means this. So only 24% of your compound is looking to the real compound. So I think we all agree you cannot make any identification of it, so it will be an unidentified compound. And this is really a nightmare for a toxicologist, so we want to avoid as much as possible to have unidentified compounds. So how one possibility to do this is to have really an extensive library, because medical devices, as you know, they are made out of so many materials, much more than in the pharma world. They are manufactured in using different processes. You have metals, polymers, biodegradable materials, and also you need into account the solvents that are used during manufacturing or cleaning or reprocessing or sterilization. So therefore you really need a database for all the different compounds, for the volatile, the semi-volatile, the non-volatile compounds. This library needs to be sufficiently extensive to capture all these different materials that are used in the medical device world. It also needs to grow continuously, because there are new materials popping up in the industry, so you need to invest time to grow your library. It needs to be reliable. And of course, what's the most important for a toxicologist, that he knows how reliable your identification is when you use that database. So therefore, we developed our Nelson Labs unique screener database, and Pete is so excited to tell everything about it. So I will give now the word to Pete, who will go to more to the hard science of identifications.